Buenos días a todos, bienvenidos a la presentación de este nuevo informe de la Agencia Internacional de la Energía llamado The Role of Critical Minerals in Clean Energy Transition. Como sabéis, junto a los informes tradicionales de la agencia, han comenzado una serie de ediciones nuevas, como puede ser la de vehículo eléctrico o la hoja de ruta para la neutralidad de emisiones 50, y este que vamos a presentar hoy, que son nuevos en el campo de la Agencia Internacional, pero creemos que tienen gran interés para el mundo energético y por eso estamos siguiendo su presentación. I'm going to switch to English because we have here our guest, Tae Yung Kim, Senior Analyst of the International Energy Agency, who is the lead of the author of the new special report. Mr. Kim, thank you for coming here. This is the first time for you presenting these reports in the Spanish Energy Press. Thank you all, and we hope that the next time you will be here presenting in our headquarters here in Madrid. Thank you for accepting our solution. Okay, this issue of the role of the rare earths and rising a lot rare earths and other minerals, this is a comprehensive and holistic approach to these minerals. And I think last week we did the presentation of geostrategy and energy. And in this report, we have done something about rare earths. In this case, we are introducing all of you in this new field about all the minerals involved in this energy transition. I celebrate that the International Energy Agency were involved in this situation. In this case, they are paying more attention to these new elements and the potential vulnerabilities as critical minerals, as copper, lithium, nickel, cobalt, and rare earth elements that are essential components in many of the clean energy technologies used today. I recommended to read this report, but these are two or three main issues I was a little bit, because they are unknown for me. No? The first of these, this is a typical electric car uses 6 times the mineral inputs of a conventional car. Or the EIA estimated that the energy sector will need 6 times more critical minerals by 2040, or that the business in 2030 about this, around these minerals, could be the same level as the business of coal, we know very well of this kind of thing. Well, this is important for the policy maker, and I thanks the energy, the agency to focus in this kind of situation, and Tae Yung Kim for coming here. After we will establish this presentation by Tae Yung Kim. After this, we have asked Vicente Gutiérrez Penador, the president of the Spanish Confederación Nacional de Empresas de la Minería y la Metalurgia, CONFEDEM, to introduce us in this kind of minerals in Spain. This is very unknown for us, and I ask him to present in 5 minutes the situation here in Nevada, this mineral. Now I'm going to give the floor to Tae Yung Kim. As I say, he is a senior analyst of the International Energy Agency, lead author of these new special reports. He works in the Energy Supply and Investment Outlook Division, and is also main contributor to the World Energy Outlook. Prior to joining the IEA, he dealt with a wide range of issues around infrastructure, finance, and developing economies at the World Bank. He also worked as senior manager at Accenture. He comes from Korea, no, as you know him. Kim, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Director General, for having me here. It's a pleasure to present, to talk about the key findings of the critical mineral report released just last month. I will put up my slide. Yeah, to start, in 2020, despite of the pandemic, we have seen some growing momentum for clean energy transitions. Many countries and companies announced pledges to reduce their emissions to net zero by mid-centuries. And the countries with those such pledges account for some 70% of global GDP and emissions. Of course, these are yet pledges, but as they turn into actions, it implies a massive acceleration in clean energy deployment. But a clean energy system is quite different from the one fueled by hydrocarbons. In a way, they need a lot of minerals and metals to build. For example, the lithium, nickel, cobalt, manganese, and graphite are vital for batteries' performance, the energy density, and longevity. And rare earth elements are crucial elements for wind turbines and electric vehicle motors. And solar panels are not very mineral intensive, but the sheer scale of their future capacity addition means plenty of additional demand for copper, silicon, and silver. And transmission and distribution lines, which are the backbone of our future power system, requires huge amount of copper and aluminum. And what this means is that as we advance energy transitions, we are shifting from a fuel-centric energy system to a more mineral-intensive energy system. For example, as Director General mentioned, a typical electric car consumes 6 times more mineral resources than a conventional car. Likewise, the offshore wind requires 13 times more mineral resources than a similar-sized gas-fired plant. Over the past decade, the amount of minerals to add a new unit of power generation capacity has increased by 50% as renewables take a growing share in new power generation investment. In general, we think there's no shortage of mineral resources in terms of absolute amount, but at the same time, there's no guarantees that the supplies will be available at affordable price when we need them. So that requires calls for some new approaches to energy securities. And in the minerals are increasingly becoming an important element in the energy security debate. And we are advising our member government and countries policymakers to expand their horizons to look at this aspect to reduce the risk of price volatility and supply disruptions. And the first question to address this topic is about how much do we need? How much could demand rise? The short answer is the concerted effort to achieve global climate goals requires a quadrupling of overall mineral requirement by 2040. And an even faster energy transition to hit the net zero emissions globally by 2050 requires 6 times more mineral resources than today by 2040. And this growth is mainly led by the electric vehicles and battery storage, but also by electricity grid networks, transmission and distribution lines, and also the low carbon power generations. But here on the chart, you are seeing 4 to 6 times demand growth, but for some minerals and some metals shows much higher the level of demand growth. For example, battery metals, for lithium, we see in a climate-driven scenario, the demand of lithium in clean energy technologies is set to expand by 40 times. And likewise, the graphite, cobalt, nickel also sees some 20 to 20 times demand growth in a climate-driven scenario. And this huge expected demand growth has some two important implications. The first implication is about the emerging share of clean energy technologies in total mineral markets. Some 10 years ago, 2010, the share of clean energy technologies in total mineral demand was quite minimal. But already in 2020, the share of the electric vehicles and battery storage became the largest consuming segment of lithium. And in our climate-driven scenario, the clean energy technologies account for some over 90% of total lithium demand globally. And a similar trend are also visible for other minerals from the cobalt, nickel, copper, rare earth element. So over time, in a climate-driven scenario, there's some strong linkages between the clean energy market and the mineral market. So the clean energy, the energy policymakers also need to understand how the mineral market works. And also there's some case for mineral, the market policymakers understand about the energy market. And the second implication is about the cost of clean energy technologies. Over the past decade, we have seen some rapid reduction in the cost of clean energy technologies because of the technology learnings and also the economies of scale. But the flip side of that, the outcome of that is the now the raw materials, minerals and metals account for a larger share of total cost of clean energy technologies. That means some changes in the mineral prices can have a major impact on the cost of clean energy technologies and in turn, the investment requirement for the clean energy transitions. So inadequate mineral supply can make our energy transition effort either slower or more expensive, which is why the energy policymakers need to pay attention to this topic. And also the IEA as an energy agency is having interest in this topic. And there are also some implications for companies that mine and process these minerals and metals. Today, the revenue from coal production is around 10 times larger than the revenue from energy transition minerals. But in a climate-driven scenario, we think this picture is set to change quite rapidly as coal use goes into structural decline and energy transition minerals gain a tailwind from rising demand and also upward pressure on prices. So the combined revenue from energy transition minerals, the overtake that of coal in well before 2040 in our climate-driven scenario. And this will have implications for companies, business strategies and portfolio. And also there are some social implications to manage for policymakers. Moving on to the supply side, and one of the key issues on the supply side is about the high level of geographical concentration of productions. So for oil, natural gas, we talk about this, the concentration of the production in OPEC countries and Middle East, but the level of concentration for nickel, cobalt, rare earth, lithium are much, much higher than that of oil or natural gas. In many cases, the top three producing nations control well over 3/4 of global production. And in some cases, a single country controls the over half of global output. But it is not just about mining. When it comes to processing, the refining operations, and the level of concentration is even more visible with China's strong presence across the board, as the country has invested heavily on the mineral supply chain to support the growth of its clean tech manufacturing industries. So the issue about this higher level of the production concentration is either DRC, Indonesia, China, wherever it is, when there are some physical supply disruptions or trade restrictions or other development happens in a major producing country, and it can have a major impact on global demand, global supply, and global prices. So the level of concentration on the supply side also matters for consumers. Another issue on the supply side is about the question about whether the future supply will be in a position to support the rapid demand growth. So for this, we look at the expected production from existing mines and also projects under construction, and to compare that with the expected demand growth in a climate-driven scenario. And the outlook and result varies depending on the minerals you're talking about. But the overall, the today's investment and supply plans are mainly geared toward the one with the gradual action and gradual and insufficient action on climate change. So in our climate-driven scenario, the expected demand growth is overtake the much higher than the expected production beyond the medium term. So there's some need for investment to pick up to cover this emerging shortfall. And we are seeing some looming mismatch between the strengthened climate ambitions and the supply of minerals. And this issue is also compounded by the long lead time to develop project. It takes usually 4 to 5 years for construction of this project, and with additional time for the permitting and the preparation and et cetera. And the other issue is about the declining resource qualities. So in Chile, for example, the average copper ore grade over the past 15 years has declined by 30%. And what is the issue of this declining resource quality means the extracting the metal contents from the lower ore grade means the requires a lot more the energy to produce. And that means they pose some upward pressure on production costs and prices and also emissions and waste problems. So this declining resource quality across the board also poses some challenges for the supply side. And the another question we heard regularly when we are conducting this analysis about because many of the energy transition minerals from the lithium to nickel and have higher emission intensity than other bulk materials. So when you take into account the emissions from mineral development, and the question is about how clean are the clean energy technologies when you consider these emissions. So for this, we look at the compare the choice today between buying a gasoline car and buying an electric car, looking at their life cycle emissions. And on the chart, for gasoline car, there are some emissions from vehicle manufacturing, but the majority of emissions comes from the fuel that is combusted. For an electric vehicle, the emissions from manufacturing phase is actually higher than the conventional car because of the battery manufacturing and also the emissions from mineral development. But even though we consider the higher emissions from the mineral development, the gap is not that huge. So the questions about life cycle emission effectively boils down to the question about the carbon intensity of electricity to charge the vehicles. So when we consider the global average electricity mix in the climate-driven scenario, the life cycle emissions of an electric vehicle is around half of that of a conventional car, with additional potential for further reduction when using cleaner electricity. So tackling the emissions from mineral development is very much a crucial and very important task, but at the same time, we think they don't negate the climate advantages of the clean energy technologies. So in the report, we presented some 6 key areas of actions to ensure the reliable and sustainable supply of minerals. The first point is about ensuring the adequate investment in diversified sources of supply. So for this, the most important thing is for policymakers to give some strong market signals saying that energy transitions are going to happen. Otherwise, the companies will be hesitant to commit large-scale capital for new project development. So some strong market signals about energy transition can reduce the risk for investment and in turn help attract more capital for new project development. And there's also scope for reinforcing some geological surveys and streamlining the permitting process and providing some financing support when needed. And also the one important thing is to raise the public perception, the awareness of the important role of minerals and metals in enabling energy transitions. And also when we are conducting the projection for future demand for many of the minerals, and there are some major sources of uncertainties, depending on the strength of climate policies and also the uncertainty about technology evolution pathways. So to understand the impact of these uncertainties, we developed some 11 alternative technology cases, look at the different technology choices and their impact on demand trajectories. So in the chart, and you are seeing the wide range of demand possible demand trajectory depending on the strength of climate policies and also technology evolution pathways. So for example, for battery chemistries and for cathode, we are looking at today, the chemistry are moving from toward high nickel chemistries. But what if there are the slower shift toward these high nickel chemistries? And it will have an impact on nickel and cobalt demand. And also there are some discussion about development of solid state batteries, which is the future, the technology evolution. And we assume in the base case, we assume the solid state batteries come to the market after 2030 and increase their market share in a gradual manner. But what if this solid state batteries come to the market much earlier and take a much larger market share than general expectations. What if the aluminum replaced copper in underground cables at a much wider scale? And what if silicon take much larger market share in the anode, the battery anode chemistries? So we look at these different the technology and the pathways. So there are so many dots and diamonds you are seeing, but the essential point is that the red and orange diamond in the chart is the demand trajectory in the sustainable development scenario, in our climate development scenario. And the blue dot means the pathways trajectory in our the stated policy scenario, which is our the business as usual scenario. So there are some gaps arising from the technology uncertainties, but the majority, major source of this gap comes from the strength of climate policies. So the uncertainty about technology evolution is something the companies need to manage as a part of the usual business strategy decisions. But the gap between the steps and SDS is something the policymakers can help narrow the gap. That is why we think the giving the strong market signals about the energy transition is very much essential to the narrow the gap and reduce the uncertainty about demand, the trajectories, and also to attract more capital for new project development. But the IEA has long been working on safeguarding energy security for many years, especially for oil, now to natural gas, to electricity. And what we have learned from such experiences is that the supply side measures are quite crucial, but they are alone not sufficient. So they need to go hand in hand with other measures on the demand and technology innovation side. So the second point is about the promoting the technology innovation at all points along the value chain. So technology innovation can cover the innovation to reduce material intensity or enable the material substitution, and also on the supply side, some technology innovation to unlock more supply from waste streams or the lower oil grade, and also the technology innovation to reduce emissions and energy use in the production phase. And the third point is about scaling of recycling. So we think the recycling can play a major role in the reducing the burden for primary supply requirement. So for some bulk materials such as copper, aluminum, steel, the system for recycling is relatively well established, but this is not yet the case for many of the energy transition minerals such as lithium and rare earth element. But we think this will have to change as we expect a surge in the amount of the spent EV batteries, solar panels, and wind turbines from around 2030. So if not managed, not addressed, and this burgeoning the volumes of spent EV batteries will increase the burden for waste management. But if well managed, this will provide a valuable sources of the mineral supply for lithium, nickel, copper, and cobalt. And we think the by 2040, the recycled quantities of copper, lithium, nickel, cobalt from spent EV batteries could reduce the combined primary supply requirement by around 10%. And the fourth point about the supply chain resilience and market transparency. So we have some tools like the emergency market response disease programs and also some periodic the stress test or the regular market monitoring. These kind of tools can help policymakers to identify the weak point, the possible the pain point, and devise the necessary actions to address those challenges. And there's also scope to increase the enhanced the market transparency, because many of these minerals today, the market size is quite small. So the pricing transparency, contractual structure is quite not very transparent. But as they grow in size, there's some more scope to increase, enhance the transparency of the market, especially on the pricing. And the fifth point is about mainstreaming the higher the environmental and social the performance standard. And we think there are some strong linkages between higher environmental and social standard and the security of supply. Because of many of the investors and consumers are calling for a volumes that is sustainably and responsibly developed. But today, the large part of production is coming from the regions with either the lower governance scores or higher emission intensity. So that what this means, if the environmental and social performance don't rise, and the consumers will need to compete for a small pool of supply to secure the responsible volumes, and that can create another market strains. So enhancing, improving the environmental and social performance is very much crucial to also ensure reliable supply of minerals. And finally, so we think there's no single country can address this problem alone. So naturally, there's some strong case for strengthened collaboration between producers and consumers to coordinate the investment decisions and have some policy dialogue, and also to promote the higher environmental and social standard, and also harmonize the regulation around recycling and across the regions. So nowadays, we are looking at some growing attention on some aspect of the mineral development, such as responsible development, and there's some strong international collaboration is happening there. But we think there's this effort need to be widened, so to cover the wider aspect from environmental recycling and also the security of supply side. So thanks for your attention. So I will stop here, and after this, the presenters comment, and then I will be happy to take any questions you have. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Tai Yun. It's a pleasure having you here. This outstanding report you are presenting. You have some felicitations here in the chat. You would like to ask Mr. Tai Yun everything that you can send to question and answer the question you will have. You can put on the chat, or you can send to Ana Padilla. She's collecting all the questions you have. After this outstanding presentation by Mr. Tai Yun, we are going to give the floor for 5 minutes to Vicente Gutierrez Peinador. He is the president of the Spanish Association of this Mining and Minerals. This is the name, not Confedem, Vicente. The floor is yours.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead. So I will share my screen to show you or to share with you some very quick slides in order for you to know a bit more of my idea. You see the screen now? I hope so. Well, this is the
we can see your screen. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. This is the updated critical raw materials list that the European Union published on the 3rd of September the last year, 2020. And we can see that the new four ones, there are the lithium. It was not in the previous list, and we didn't expect to have lithium in this critical raw materials list, but the situation, as Tai Yun commented, and all of us could know, this is that lithium will be a big demand mineral, is already a big demand mineral currently. So if we go to the Spanish situation, we can see that from all the critical material list, the red bullets are the ones we have in Spain. So we are a rich country in this aspect. In fact, we are the third country behind Sweden and Finland of having the biggest mineral resources availability in Spain. So we should profit this situation. In a quick way, we can go to the map, and then I will present for you just the what happened in Spain. We can go quickly for you to have an idea in your mind of how we have the situation. This is the critical raw materials in Spain, and we can go one by one, or at least for the most important ones. This is the stibium, antimonium, beryllium and magnesite or magnesium. We have cobalt, lithium, graphite in the area of Extremadura. We can go to chromium, nickel, titanium, tantalum and niobium. We have the only European mine on coltan here in the south of Galicia. It's already working, recycling the old waste, but they also will go in underground to mine those two minerals associated with titanium, I forgot the name, but it's associated with, but what, this is the only European mine on coltan. Then we have wolfram. A lot of companies already are mining wolfram, exporting wolfram from Spain, and phosphate rocks, etc. We presented to the Ministry of Ecologic Transition, is in charge of those the national plan of integrated energy and climate. We presented what is the state of Spain, in particular in wolfram. You see here wolfram, cobalt, copper, lithium, nickel, manganese, silver, and what in terms of resources we have and what we could mine. I can say that Spain could be self-supported on those materials, and even we can export, because in particular in wolfram we can export copper, we can export, etc. So copper is not a critical material, but it's a strategic material, because copper, aluminium, and steel are horizontal for all technologies, independently for the final technology whose goal for the best one in the energy transition, there will be always copper, silver, aluminium, and steel should be needed to make the infrastructure. Yeah, you have to remember that just the car, the electric car, needs 5 times more copper than a normal car. So this is the map of Spain in terms of resources. Those I told you before. And just to finish, I can take two conclusions in this aspect, in order to connect it with the presentation of Thi Jung. EU, the European Commission, reviewed the industrial strategy recently in May. And they say the horizons are 2030 and then in 2050. What happened in 2030? We are not going to have any mine of those needed minerals, because permitting time for a mine in all Europe is an average of 8 to 10 years. It means we are now in 2021, so maybe in 2030 we will start those new projects or new mines, because the permitting time so high, so long. The Commission, in this case, should put something in place to help member states to shorten these timings, because if not, we are going to be out of the market. They are preparing everything, technologies, innovation, etc. But we still need the access to the resources. That was the second pillar for the European Innovation Partnership. But there is still not in place anything to allow member states to increase, to reduce the permitting time. And it could be done for sure, because we are not an exception. And in some regions in Spain, we can go up to 3-4 years, like in Andalusia. Andalusia is like an oasis in Europe in this moment. They reduce the permitting time without losing any item in the way, to 3 to 5 years instead of 10 years. This is then the other big issue is the NIMBY, not in my backyard attitude, that is supported mainly by the policymakers. The non-sustainable meaning is supported by this attitude, because people still by mobile phones, still by computers, still by anything in communication product that are using, for instance, coltan. Coltan, cobalt in particular, as you saw in the slides from Tiyung, are coming from the Democratic Republic of Congo, and where we are sure that there is not sustainability there to mine these kind of things. While in Europe, all the mining projects will be sustainable by law. They will. They are not sustainable mining project in Europe because we cannot do it. It's impossible in Europe to have this. But there's still the NIMBY attitude. This attitude should be changed because it's not ecologist at all. We don't want to have impact in our country, but we don't mind if the impact is outside of our country. This is the big link between the ESG and the supply security that also Tiyung shows in the last slide. This is the situation. So this is my final conclusion. We should put in place some rules, some procedures to guarantee the access to resources through sustainable mining, that we can do it.
Okay. Vicente, thank you very much for your presentation of the situation here in Spain of these minerals, or materials and minerals. And I'm going to give the floor. There are many questions raised. The presentation of Tiyung, and I'm going to give to Ana the floor to ask him about all the questions their report have raised in our people. Ana, you have a lot of questions in the chat, a lot of questions over there.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Tiyung. Yes, there is many questions. We can start, if you like, with one related to the last study from the IEA, no, the net zero by 2050. They're asking why it's not estimated the critical minerals need for this scenario in this new report of the IEA. And also related to that, why in the report the net zero issues of critical minerals availability is not is almost not taken into account. If you want to start with that.
In the net zero report, actually there's some section discussion about talking about these critical mineral issues. So we have some high level estimation about demand in the net zero scenario. And we also briefly discussed the issue of critical minerals in the report in the chapter. And also in the critical mineral report and in the executive summary, we presented some high level the estimation about the demand trajectory in the net zero scenario. But we did not present more detailed result about the net zero scenario trajectory because the practical reasons, because this critical mineral report was published earlier than the net zero report. So at the time of this modeling, this report, and then the numbers for natural report was not very available in detail. So there's some practical constraint, and because why we focus on the climate driven scenario, the SDS scenario, as a basis for these projections. But essentially, even the demand trajectory in the sustainable development scenario also shows the directions of travels. So where we are heading and what level of what scale is we are talking about. So we think there are some, it gives some good indication about the future trend. And we also planned the strengths in our projection in the net zero scenario in the upcoming publications in the World Energy Outlook 2021. So I want to let you stay tuned for that.
Thank you, Tiyung. Yeah, there is also a question related to the zinc consumption for PV. I think you have said something in the chat already, but maybe you want to further to give some more details. And then there is also one related to hydrogen, because it will play a key role in the energy transition. Electrolyzer require also some minerals like palladium, platinum, iridium. Do you also see a risk in the supplies of these minerals? Do you want to answer something about these two questions? Thank you.
So in terms of the scope of demand assessment, we included a wide range of minerals from all the way from lithium, nickel, cobalt to zinc and other minerals. So zinc was included in the scope of demand assessment, but the after the assessing the demand, and we narrowed down to five the deep dive focus minerals to look at the both demand and supply side in balance. So for those, we focused on the lithium, nickel, cobalt, rare earths, and copper as a five the focus minerals, because they play a major role in many of the clean energy technologies. And also the energy sector is the major driver in driving demand growth of these minerals. So that's why we focus on these five focus minerals in the report for deep dive. But in overall, in the demand assessment, we also included zinc. And we understand also recognize the important role of zinc in enabling the solar and other technologies. And for hydrogen, there are two elements. One is the electrolyzer to produce hydrogen and also the fuel cells. And both of these technologies also consumes quite a sizable amount of minerals. But for electrolyzers, and there are some different types. So today, the PEM type electrolyzer consumes the palladium and platinum. But there are some other types like the SOEC and alkaline electrolyzers, and that consumes different types of minerals, nickel and zirconium. So the mineral demand can develop in a different direction depending on the how each of these electrolyzer technologies take a market share. But fuel cells, it's true that this requires the platinum and use palladium. And so in some cases, iridium. So the companies are working hard to reduce the material intensity for the hydrogen technologies, because in terms of the absolute amount, volume-wise, it's not very the sizable amount, but this palladium and platinum are very expensive and very, in terms of monetary values, it's very costly material. So it adds some cost of hydrogen technologies, and where the cost reduction is essentially needed. So many companies we talk with many companies working on these hydrogen technologies, and they are working hard to reduce the material intensity, material use in these technologies. So we have seen some progress on this side, and we expecting some more improvement in terms of mineral intensity in the hydrogen technologies.
Thank you. There is also a question regarding the role problem in Europe. Now, what could be the role of Europe in the new future mineral world? We are going towards fossil fuels dependence from OPEC to mineral resources and processes in China. Related to that, there is another one that is asking if do you think that in the future will be necessary to build stocks for critical minerals as the OECD has done for the oil?
Europe, it is true that even we make a transition towards more renewable rich, electrified world, but concerns about this geographical and some geopolitical issues does not go away. So it is still there with a different set of players in play. But I think Europe can make an effort to address these issues on multiple fronts. On the mining side, Europe is not a major resource holder, although Spain, Portugal has some resources. So there's somewhere it is feasible, there's some strong need to develop some mining project. And as Vicente mentioned, and for this, the streamlining and shortening the permitting time is crucial. And also the raising the public awareness is also crucial, we think, because many people think regard the minerals and metal industry, not the industry of the future, but also to recognize the important role of minerals and metals in clean energy transition. So there's some scope to raise the public awareness on this front. But it is not just about mining. It is also, there's some scope to increase the capacity for processing operations. And especially the possible strains on the processing side is even greater than the mining side, we think. And the level of concentration is also very high in a single country in China. So, and for now, this was not very big issue because the clean tech manufacturing was concentrated in Asia and China. But nowadays, with the energy transition and European Union, United States, and many countries are stepping up their effort to build local supply chains for many of the clean tech equipment. And in that sense, and This gives some rationale for you to think about the pay attention to the issue of the processing operations. So, and when you build the domestic battery manufacturing, solar panels, and wind turbine manufacturing capacity, then there's some strong case to consider also how the processing capacity can support this local supply chain effort. And also the advantage that European Union might have is the higher the environmental and social standard. So the promoting the mainstreaming, the higher environmental and social standard globally can have this kind of effort to diversify the sources of operations. And the finally, we think the some for European Union is a major the consumer of electric vehicle and solar panels in the coming future. And that means the in terms of recycling, the for recycling, especially the regions with a higher level of greater level of the green tech deployment has advantages. And they have a much wider economies of scale. So pushing hardly this on the recycling side is can bring some greater benefit in ensuring the security of supply, we think. So there's some strong case to promote recycling operations in the European Union, I think. And in terms of stockpiling, and yeah, you know this, the IEA has long been working on the coordinated oil stockpiles to ensure the security of supply. So there's some natural question about whether we consider similar kind of schemes in the mineral field as well. But at the moment, we don't have a plan for such coordinated the stockpiling mechanism because the there are some variety of minerals, not just a single commodity. So you have the different types of minerals and also along the value chain. And each country region has some different pain point and possible challenges and possible opportunities. So it is quite difficult to pinpoint the globally coordinated single the stockpiling mechanisms. So, but for Asia, some single region and countries, and we think there are some need to consider the voluntary the stockpiling mechanisms based on the country's own assessment about the possible demand and supply pictures. So especially for the minerals with some smaller market size and less transparency, and some there are some scope to consider the voluntary stockpiling, we think.
Thank you. There is another question about renewables, no? Based on what you have presented, if do you think it's realistic that the cost of renewables as wind and solar and also batteries is gonna go down in the future?
Yeah, actually this is a very great question. And this is why we wanted to incorporate this mineral metal aspect in our world energy models to the mineral metal consideration can also influence the projection about long-term energy trend and demand and supply. And in terms of the share of minerals and metals in total cost of green energy technologies, and the share varies depending on technologies. For solar and onshore wind, the minerals don't account for a large share in the total cost. So we think in general, it's still the managing the mineral prices in a reasonable range is crucial, but it does not hamper the cost reduction in solar PV and the onshore wind, we think. But for batteries, for example, the minerals and metals are a very big chunk of cost element. So we estimate some 35% of the total battery cost today comes from this mineral element. So, and this mineral element, the direction forward, going forward, this could move in different directions. But other cost elements can be reduced further with the technology learnings and economic scale. But this minerals and metal component might move in different directions. And that will pose some pressure to further reduce the cost of batteries and electric vehicles. So that is also implemented in the future projections. So we assume some further reduction in the cost of batteries for the coming years, but there are some flaw in those cost reductions. So we did not assume that battery cost to go further down the road because of the consideration about these minerals and metals. So that is one of the reason in the net zero scenario, we also urge some more technological innovation about the solid state batteries or batteries with much higher energy density. without such kind of technology innovation or some fundamental changes in the chemistries and otherwise the minerals and metals can pose some major challenges in the battery cost in the future. So that is why we are urging the both the technology innovation on the battery side and also some actions on the supply mineral supply side to balance these issues.
Thank you. You have talked quite a lot about recycling, but there is a very precise question here regarding the amount of energy needed for the recycling process and how much is going to need energy is going to need for 2040 for the recycling material and products.
Yeah, actually, we haven't looked at the energy consumption in the recycling process, so I don't have a very clear answer on that questions. But in general, the recycling, the energy consumption emissions from the recycling operations is much smaller than the emissions energy used in the mining and processing operations. So in general, there's some advantage when you use more recycled materials, and there's some advantages in the amount of energy use and also emissions. But for exact the values, and we need to do more work to understand the exact numbers.
Thank you. Also related to recycling, they are asking if there is you can give us an example of a specific action need in order to scale up the recycling, and if is there any country that is advancing on these issues quicker than others?
So in terms of these actions to scale up recycling, I think the most important thing is to increase the collection rate. And this is the most important indicator to ensure more volumes available for recycling. So today, the collection rate varies depending on the component and end-use applications. But we think the batteries, spent batteries and solar panel wind turbines can be more easily collected than other, for example, the consumer electronics. So if the countries and regions put in place some structures to efficiently collect and sort the spent materials, and it can raise the collection rate quite a lot. And this can in turn to guarantee the more the efficient recycling processes. But there are also some other the regulatory measures and also some scope for business model development. For example, the regulation about recycling is quite different by the countries. So each region, each country has its own the regulatory framework for recycling, but it's not often harmonized. But the product and materials, critical equipment are moving globally across the board. So essentially some we think there are some scope to harmonize this recycling regulation among the major regions to ensure more the sustained supply of these recycled materials. And also there are some questions about business model development. So whether today some independent recyclers are in charge of this collecting materials and they are in charge of this recycling materials, but there's also interest from OEMs or battery manufacturers to chip in. And so how the business model development, who will be in a central position to collect and recycle these spent batteries and so wind turbines is one of the key questions we need to think about to scale up recycling. And in terms of regions and today the Asian countries like China and other the Northeast Asian countries have some frontier, but Europe is following, but all, I would say the all at the starting stage. So today the amount of spent battery is quite minimal. But over time, and this amount will burgeon, will bloom, we think. So maybe in the mid 2020s and 2030s, and there will be some huge inflow of spent batteries and solar panels. So, and how to tackle this, the burgeoning, possibly burgeoning volumes of spent materials is the key task for many regions, and everybody is at the starting stage. So who will take the lead in this field is the key question. But I think the European Union is one of the regions is best positioned to lead the global recycling effort.
Thank you. There is another one regarding the international collaboration. You pointed out that it's very important. And does the publication include information about the new energy trade patterns that the transition to clean energy is bringing? Could you please give us some details about a specific partnership for Europe with other countries or Spain with other countries?
Maybe I may not be able to give some specific examples, but in general, from international collaborations, we are, until now, we have seen some two major trends. So one is this some growing attention on the social aspect of development. So you know this, the child labor in DRC has got a lot of attention from the companies. And so there are some strengthened the international effort to tackle those issues in DRC. And there are some good progress made over the past few years, although still we have a long way to go to fundamentally tackle these issues. But at the same time, there has been some progress with many international partners and companies being involved. And also on the second side, and some producers like US and Canada operating this the energy resources governance initiatives, which they aim to promote their some best practices and sustainable and responsible development practices to a wider set of countries. And there are some collaboration between the producers. But we think the scope of international collaboration need to broaden to incorporate the wider aspect, not just the responsible development, but also the sustainable development, including the environmental impact and emission angles, and also the how to promote recycling in a coordinated manner. And also there are some scope for the policy dialogue to coordinate investment decisions. And that is the one aspect that international collaboration can expand. And also the second aspect is about involving both consumers and producers. So many of the producers of minerals, and it's quite, there are some collaboration effort already going on, but we think there are also some scope for the enhanced conversation between the consumers of minerals and also producers of minerals. That is the more or less the what we think.
Thank you very much. There is also a question regarding the, you know, the difficulties in Europe of having permissions for new mines in minerals. What do you think about the role of government for this, about the social acceptability issues, maybe regarded to that as well? Well, if you want to comment first on this, maybe also our Vicente Gutierrez want to add something as well, if you want, because the question, I think, is for both of you. It's in the chat. Thank you.
Yeah, I think maybe this permitting issue, and Vicente is better placed to answer the fundamental challenges. But I think the reducing, the shortening the project development time is very much essential. And for this, the reducing, the shortening the permitting process, permitting time is quite crucial in also in the European Union and also in other parts of the world, especially in the United States. And essentially, there's some strong role for government to play. And as the government and policymakers pay attention to this topic and this shortening this time and reducing the lead time is quite crucial. And if you look at the past the project and how much they took to develop, and there's some wide range of values. Some took more than 10 years and 15 years, but some took quite the short time. So there's some possibility you can shorten this permitting time, permitting process, although the environmental consideration, social consideration should not be sacrificed. But I think we think there are some scope to reduce this the permitting time. Maybe Vicente is better, maybe add more word on this front.
Yes, it is clear that that should could be done perfectly. There is an excuse systematically. The Commission says we cannot intervene in. We cannot intervene in the member state legislation, but this is not true, because Natura 2000 directive goes directly to the member state legislation, and we always say we don't need maybe such a high level of directive, but we could need some communication from the Commission in order to say to the member states, look, you should put your permitting time in such a way that the timing should be reduced. For instance, this is a typical situation in Spain, and mostly of the processes through the administration goes to the non-answer. If the administration didn't answer you, this is enough. But this not answer could be 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. You never know. One thing that could be perfectly done by the Commission is say, you should put a timing, a real time to answer the project situations, and not say the no answer from the administration is something that is quite easy for them. And they could move this kind of thing. And like this, they could move another kind of small things to force the member state to include in the legislation some pieces to shorten the period, because I insist, Andalusia is one of the regions in Spain, did it. So currently a mining project in Andalusia could go through 3, maybe 4 or 5 years, not 10 years that the rest of the country. So we can perfectly, or they could perfectly do.
Thank you very much to both of you. And there is, we are a little bit late already, but there is some question more. Arkady, if you want, I can.
Okay, you can give ahead, but there are people who ask Vicente, they propose new things, no more than to say that we are in 10 years for developing this. No, there are questions raised here about the how can we make this easier, no, for that, and at the same time to keep the environment and in the regulation under control at the same level. This is this is the challenge, no?
No, this is the challenge, but they could be done because the tools are in other countries. We can go to those third countries mining, like Australia and Canada, or North America, but mainly Canada and Australia, or maybe go to Sweden or Finland, where the social aspect are perfectly considered and analyzed before a project is on the line. Why? Through a special working groups prepared into the administration. It means when a project asking for a mining permit goes to the administration, the question here in Spain currently is we have to wait for the answer of the administration to the EIT, to the environmental EIA, to the minimal assessment, study assessment. And the question is why we have to wait all the time until all the answers are prepared. Those countries like Australia and Canada, and Sweden and Finland work in the document from the starting day of presentation. The questions, the doubts that the administration officers could raise are solved in a quarterly period. Every 15 days they meet, they solve the problems, they answer. This commission is usually formed by the university, the company, and the administration. And then when you have 1 year, you have already answered all the questions, not just you have to wait 1 year to have the document and then answer to the document.
Maybe it's to working together. No, this is the solution you are proposing.
This is the solution. This
okay.
is the solution.
Anna, give the last question for Tai Jung, no? For Mr. Tai Jung.
Okay, yes, maybe related to the just transition, your views on the role of the critical mineral on the just transition. Does the publication include a sample of regions reconverting coal mines to critical minerals?
Yeah, I think the the in terms of just transition and switching, transitioning from coal to the energy transition minerals is, for some regions is doable, because some Australia, South Africa, they both have coal and energy transition mineral resources, but it may not be the case for all other countries. So there could be some social implications to manage in these regions. So for in terms of technologies and capabilities, and there are some overlaps, so they can be usefully exploited. But for other, there's some location issues. So coal mines and energy transition mines are not necessarily located in the same regions. So still, this how to manage the decline in coal use and the coal mining jobs is then another separate issue, need to be managed by policymakers separately. But to the extent possible, can be switched to the energy transition mineral development, but depends on the location of the mines and things like that.
Thank you very much. It's all from my side. I think, Arcadio, if you want
okay. Yes. Thank you very much, you. Mr. Tai Jun, Mr. King. Thank you very much, Vicente. As you can see, this is a hot topic. It raised a lot of questions about recycling. How can you put this into the net zero roadmap that Laura and Araceli presented last week here? And this is a very this topic about the speed or how long it would be all the permits you will need to open the new mines in Europe. Now this is topic issues. I encourage all of you and I thank all of you for this report. This is the first of the line. It would be the last, I'm sure, completely sure about that. And thank you very much for presenting here. I hope you will be here, both of you will be here next time in the crew for doing that. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you very much, Piso. Muchos buenos días a todos ustedes. Buenos días. Gracias, Ana.
Hello. Thank you.
Thank you.